Well, how many know there's power in the name of Jesus? I said, how many know there's power in the name of Jesus? Everyone standing on your feet, just grab somebody by the hand and say, neighbor, whether you know it or not, there's power in his name. That's why you can't play with that name, because there's so much power in that name. Whee! What's his name? There is power. Power. Heal the sick, sick soul, and make the wounded whole. Oh, there's no more. Come on and clap your hands and praise the Lord if you know there's power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. There is power in his name. Well, how many of you are glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Hallelujah. Glad to be in the house of the Lord this third Sunday in January. We're really halfway through. January 15th, we're at the halfway mark of 2017 in January. The Lord has brought us from a long way. And we come to give him praise this morning. We've been praying. We've been fasting. This is the end of our 14-day fast. Oh, and God has been gracious to us. He's been merciful to us. And this is the day where we have been fasting and praying, and we've not been asking God for anything. We've just been praising and thanking God for what we have prayed and believed God for. So what I want you to do for the next 30 seconds, I want you to forget about everything that's going on around you. Forget about what's going on at home. Forget about your bills. Don't remember, don't forget, or remember what happened last week. Some of you get your mind off whether I left the pot on at home. Don't remember that. But I want you for the next 30 seconds to give God uninterrupted praise. I'm going to count to three, and I just want you to erupt in praise. All right? One. Two, three, come on, let's lift up a praise in this house. Hallelujah. Hey. Come on. Let's fill this place with praise. Come on and let's fill this place with praise. Come on, let's raise your praise up. Raise it up. Raise up your praise. Hallelujah! Yee, glory, 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 glory! And we bless your name, God. And we bless your name, and we bless your name. And we bless your name, and we bless your name, God. We magnify your name. We glorify your name. There's none like you in the heavens and none like you on the earth. And we bless your name today. We bless your name, God. Yee, glory! Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Bless his name. Whee! Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Now, Father, we thank you today and we praise you. We give you glory one more time. For we recognize that there's no one like you. No one like you in the heavens and no one like you on the earth. And God, we reverence your sweet and holy name. We lift your name on high. God, we know that there's power in your name. And so, God, we call on your name today. For we know that there is no other help that we have but in Jesus. And so, Father, we ask for your anointing this morning, the kind of anointing that breaks the yoke of the enemy, the kind of anointing that changes lives. Someone came this morning discouraged, on the verge of giving up. But I pray that this word will go forth that will encourage them, that will uplift them, that will speak life into their dead situations. In the mighty name of Jesus. And say, Satan, we serve you notice today that your contracts have been canceled. In the name of Jesus, you have no authority in this place. But we've been praying and we've been fasting and we've been consecrating ourselves, and we are expecting God to move. And so, Satan, you might as well pack your bags now and leave this place. For you have no authority in this place. You have no authority in this place. But all the glory, all the honor, and all the power belongs to God. And we're coming through here. Yes, we are. Yes, we are. Yes, we are. Yes, we are. We're coming through with the victory. We're coming through with our hands lifted. We're coming through with the praise on our lips. We're coming through giving you glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name. Thank God. Thank God. Amen and amen. 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 Glory to God. Yee! Glory to God. Glory. Glory. Yee! Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Well, there is a word from the Lord. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, is where we're going as you remain standing for the word of the Lord. Hebrews 12, 2 and 3. We're just reading two verses there. Hebrews 12, 2 and 3. Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Second verse and the third verse. If some of you didn't bring your Bibles, it's in your bulletins. And you can read along with us the second and the third verse of the 12th chapter of Hebrews. For the word of the Lord says, let's read together, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. I just came to tell somebody to stay focused. Tell somebody, grab your hand, grab a hand, grab a hand, and tell your neighbor, neighbor, I want you to stay focused. God has given us a word already. You better stay focused, stay focused, stay focused. This is the crowning year of blessings. And you better hold on to the word and stay focused. You may have your seats in the presence of the Lord. Stay focused. The enemy wants you to not believe what God has already said. He wants to stop you from believing that God is going to do what he has already promised. Reality is, if some of you are like me, this year has come in with a bang. I've experienced, all types of problems. Car trouble, plumbing problems, kids getting sick. Deaths and sicknesses and problems on top of problems. And I said to myself, this seems in total contradiction to what God has already said. Because you said, Lord, this was the crowning year of blessings, and it seems like the blessings have not come, and I'm experiencing not blessings, but I'm experiencing problems. Is there anybody with me this morning? This year you expecting and it's 15th day and you said, Lord, I hope some things turn around. I hope some things work out because right now it ain't looking so good. But the Lord told me to tell you to stay focused on my word. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what the enemy is doing. I don't care how the enemy is acting up. The reality is, God just dropped this in my spirit just right now. This is fresh off the press. That the reason why you are going through more than you really are, and it seems like the enemy has turned up the heat, is because the blessing is going to be bigger than you ever imagined. So the devil knows that his time is limited because God is getting ready to bless his people. And so he's turning up the heat. So if you feel like the devil has turned up the heat, don't be fooled because it has. Just know that the blessing is on its way. Blessing is on its way. So if the enemy can make you give up, if the enemy can make you stop, the enemy can block you from receiving that which God has for you. As we have to be keenly aware of the enemy's tactics, because the enemy doesn't want you to obtain what God has waiting on you. So in order to receive all that God has for you this year, you must keep focused. The Lord wanted me to tell you today, don't get distracted on your way to your blessings. I want you to repeat that after me. Don't get distracted on your way to your blessing. Last week we talked about God is going to shower blessings upon us. This is the crowning year of blessings, but don't get distracted on your way to your blessing. For if you get distracted, you will forfeit your blessing. I'll say that again. If you get distracted and get off kilter and get off focus, you will forfeit that which God has for you. Distractions lead to lack of belief. But God is true to his word. No matter what the devil throws in front of you, you must say it until it gets down in your spirit that I believe God to fulfill his promise in my life. When God gives a word, we must stand in faith to believe that it will come to pass. When God gives a word, it's like a seed that he plants within our hearts and in our minds. And it's like the sower in Luke chapter 8 who sows the seed. And the Bible says in the 7th and 8th verses, the 7th verse he says, and some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. He's talking about the seed that the sower planted in the ground. That some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it, and the thorns choked out the seed from producing. But the 8th verse says, and others fell on good ground and sprang up and bare fruit an hundredfold. In other words, those might have fell on bad ground because they fell among thorns. Some of the seeds fell among good ground, and the good ground is going to produce great fruit. And the seed that has been planted in the ground is not only going to bear great fruit, but the Bible says a hundredfold. In other words, it's going to produce more and more and more. And when the disciples asked, what did this parable mean, Jesus, concerning the seed that fell among thorns, Jesus says that these are people who, when they have heard or hear the word, they go forth and are choked with the cares and riches of the pleasures of this life. In other words, they asked Jesus, what meaneth this parable? And they have been, because they don't understand what's going on. Jesus tells them that these are people, the ones that fell among thorns are people. When they hear the word, they go forth and they are distracted. They are choked out from receiving what God has for them. Well, in other words, they have allowed the cares of this world to choke the word out from them. And therefore, they cannot produce any fruit because they have allowed their problems to distract them from what God has planted in them. Don't get distracted. But Jesus says you need to allow the word to fall on good ground. Good ground or good soil. These are people that hear the word in honesty and bring forth fruit with patience. So into your hearts and minds, God says, I plant a seed. I plant the word of God down in your spirit, but allow it to be on good ground. Because when the seed has been planted on good ground and good soil, it will produce great fruit. So hear the word of the Lord today. Don't get distracted. Allow the word to sink into your minds. Allow the word to sink into your spirits. Stay focused because God says that this is the year of the crowning blessings. Allow that word to sink into your spirits and allow the word to grow within you and produce great fruit. You have to make this declaration that I believe God. Do I have anybody in this house that says I believe God? I want you to lift your hands if that's you today, and you don't care what the devil is doing in your life. You don't care what the enemy is trying to muster up in your life. I want you to declare this morning that I don't care what the devil is doing, I believe God. Come on, I wish somebody really believed that. Shout it again, I believe God. I feel something there. I dare you to say it one more time and make the devil out of a liar. When you say it, I want you to say it until it rises up from your belly. I want you to say, I believe God.
I believe God.
Come on and give God praise in this house. God, you ought to point to somebody and say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but I believe God. I believe God. I believe that God is going to do what he has already said. And what God has said, it's got to come to pass. Woo, my God. It's got to come to pass. The devil is trying to do everything to make you not believe that God is going to do what he said. But God said, if I said it, I'm going to do it. If I spoke it, I'm going to bring it to pass. Because my word will not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I set it out to do. If God has given you a word, you can take it to the bank. If God has given you a word, you can stand on that word. If God has given you a word, I don't care what distractions are around you. And see, here's another thing. You got to get around some positive folks. Because some people are going to call you crazy. Some people are going to say, that don't make sense. Some people are going to get around you and say, well, that don't, what is wrong with you? You're out of your mind? Oh, no, I'm not out of my mind. I just believe God. I'm not crazy. I just stand on faith. I'm not crazy, but I'm a faith walker. I'm walking by faith and not by sight. Bible tells us, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. I may not see it, but I believe God for it. Because if you see it, it's not faith. You don't need faith if you can see it. If you can see your way out, if you can, you know, you can pull your savings account and your CDs and, you know, you can, you know, get it and put the money together to make it happen, you don't need faith. But brothers and sisters, when you don't have nothing and you looking at your bills and you looking at your money, and the two don't match. Faith steps in and says, I may not see the money, but I believe God is going to take care of the bills. I wish I could talk to somebody this morning. Because the enemy wants you to think that God is limited by what you have. Oh, but my God, brothers and sisters, God is not limited by what you have, because my God can do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or you can think. Therefore, you cannot limit God. And that your problem that you're going through, your situation that you are up against, is not too hard for God. Jeremiah asked the question, is there anything too hard for God? What's the answer? No, there's nothing too hard for God. I don't care what you're, I don't care what you're facing, it's not too hard for God. Yeah, it's too heavy for you. It's too hard for you. You can't make it happen. You can't make it work out. But what if you put it in God's hands and release it? Somebody needs to have a release this morning. Somebody needs to release it. Somebody needs to release. You need to release your situation. You need to release your problem. You need to release your problem. You need to release it. Release it. Release it. Let God handle it. Let God work it out. Let God handle it. I wish I had somebody that say, I'm getting ready to release it today. I'm not getting ready to take it no more. I'm not taking it back home. I'm going to leave it right here. I'm going to leave it right here on the altar. I'm not taking it back home today, but today is a new day. And the devil cannot distract me anymore. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The devil can't distract me anymore. But I've got a release coming. A release of my problems to God. Well, have your seats. I've got a little ways to go. Our text today, Hebrew writer starts this chapter with the understanding we are in a race. We're in a journey. And that we must endure to the end. So he tells us in the second verse where our focus ought to be while we are on this journey. He says, looking unto Jesus. Our focus must be upon Jesus. Not the cares of this world. Not the situations that we are up against. But we must allow our focus to be on Jesus. And let me just tell you this, you got to take your focus off people. Because some of us are in relationships that are holding us back. I'm talking to somebody this morning. You're in a relationship that you have no business being in, and it's distracting you from getting what God has for you. But our focus must be upon the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The New American Standard Version translates this beautifully. Fixing our eyes on Jesus. In other words, I set my eyes upon Jesus. I'm setting my focus on Jesus. And when you fix your eyes on something, you're not looking to the right, you're not looking to the left, but you are keeping your eyes straight ahead on Jesus. We can only run the race as we look to Jesus and have our eyes locked on to him. He is our focus. He is our inspiration. He is our example. If we are going to receive that which God has for us, our eyes must be settled on him. He goes on further to say why we should keep our eyes on him. He says, because he is the author and the finisher of our faith. In other words, he is the beginning and the ending of our faith. Our faith begins with him and it ends with him. Our faith starts with him and our faith stops with him. The main idea of this is not only that he is the beginning and the ending, but that he is with us the entire time we are running the race. Say that again. He is with us the entire time we are running the race. That he is the author. He is at the beginning of the race. And if we keep our eyes on Jesus, he will be with us at the end of the race. So he is the author of the race. He's at the beginning, at the starting point, and he's at the stopping point. He says he is the author and the finisher of our faith. Philippians 1:6 says, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. If we keep our eyes on him, we have the assurance that he will allow us to reach our goal. Somebody shout, stay focused. Stay focused. Stay focused. Don't get distracted. We must put our blinders on. You seen horses that are in a race. They put blinders on. The jockeys put the blinders on them because they will get distracted. Horses have a tendency to look out of their peripheral. And when they look out of their peripheral view, they begin to go where their eyes go. But we must put on blinders and we must keep out everything that is distracting us and look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Continues by telling them to Jesus for the joy that was set before him. Endured the cross. No, the cross that Jesus endured was not joyous. What he had to endure did not feel good. But he knew what was coming on the other side of the cross. Was the joyous to know that those who would believe on him would have eternal life. For if Jesus didn't endure the cross, we wouldn't have the right to salvation. For if Jesus didn't endure the cross, we would be still dead in our trespasses and sin. If Jesus hadn't endured the cross, we would still be separated from God. If Jesus had not endured the cross, we would still be separated. There would be a veil between God and man. But thank God for Jesus, that when Jesus stepped on the scene, the Bible says that the veil of the temple was rent in two. In other words, that we may have access to the Father. We did not have access until Jesus came. But now we have a mediator between God and man, and his name is what? I'm gonna try. He endured the cross for you and me. He endured the pain. He endured the agony. He endured the thorns on his head. He endured the stripes on his back. He endured the shame of the cross. Continues by telling them, he encourages us that if we endure the cross, if Jesus endured the cross, no matter what our trials are, no matter what our situations are, we can endure too. If you are going to make it, you must endure. You must forbear. You must have endurance. This race, I know we usually say that the Bible says this, but the Bible doesn't say this. That the race is not given to the swift nor to the strong, but the one that endure to the end. That's not the Bible. However, it is true. It's not in the scripture, but it's the truth. That if you're going to plan to win, if you plan to run the race, and if you plan to reach your goal, you're going to have to endure. It's not going to be easy. And sometimes we think that just because we get saved, everything is going to be easy. Everything is going to be a flowery bed of ease. We're going to just skate along and we're just going, you know, mosey on through life and everything's going to be well. We're not going to have another cloudy day. But brothers and sisters, I came to tell you, it's not that you won't have a cloudy day, but you will realize that the clouds will after a while give way to sunshine. Why? Because Jesus is in you. And even though it may be cloudy, God can still give you joy on the inside. Not because of the situation, but Jesus in you will give you joy. So, if you're going to make it, you're going to have to endure. Tell somebody, neighbor, you're going to have to endure. Yeah, you're going to have to endure. You're going to have to endure. The Bible says, Paul says, endure hardness as a good soldier. You're going to have to endure. You're going to have to endure some lies. You're going to have to endure some people talking about you. And you can't be so sensitive that every time somebody says something about you, you're going home and saying, I'm not going back no more. You can't wear your feelings on your sleeves around here. I mean, you're going to have some grit. You're going to have some cross, because everything is not going to go your way. Hello, somebody. And I think that a lot of times we have become spoiled and entitled. Whereas the longer as things are going well, we are right. But the minute things turn around and they're not going the way we want them to go, we mad, we upset, nobody can't talk to you, you angry, you can't speak to nobody, you mad, you sitting up here with your arms folded. I know that you may be going through, but brothers and sisters, if you have Jesus on the inside, he'll give you joy, unspeakable joy. So we have to endure. Assurance we have, brothers and sisters, that trouble really doesn't last always. That God won't allow you to go through situations and not have some good waiting on the other side of it. But there's some good waiting on you on the other side of your situation. There's some joy on the other side. But in order to get what God has for you, you're going to have to endure. So the writer says that Jesus endured because he knew what the goal was in the end. He endured the shame of the cross. The Bible says that he despised the shame. The death of the cross was not only gory, but it was meant to be shameful. It was meant to embarrass him. Could have died normal death. They could have killed him and, you know, shot him or stabbed him and put him somewhere else. But brothers and sisters, he had to go on the cross because they wanted to make an open shame of him. And so not only was the cross a terrible way to die, because the cross did not, as you were hanging on the cross, you didn't die immediately. But it took some time. It was a slow and agonizing death. And so Jesus was laying or standing there on the cross and had to endure the shame of the cross. He endured it because he knew what you and I needed. Sometimes going through is embarrassing. Sometimes it's difficult to go through, but brothers and sisters, you have to endure the embarrassment. You're going to have to endure the shame, because in the end, you will be victorious. You ought to just tell somebody, neighbor, the reason why you have to endure is because victory is on the other side of the problem. And if you give up now, if you stop going now, if you give up the fight now, if you throw in the towel now, you won't receive what God has on the other side of your trial. But if you can just endure a little while longer, I don't know how long you've got to go through it. I don't know how long you've got to cry over it. I don't know how long the midnight may be. I don't know how long your night season may be. But all I know is that weeping may endure for a night. But somebody shout, joy is coming in the morning. If you can endure the night, God said you got a morning coming, and so I don't know about you, but I'm going to hold fast to that which is good. I'm going to hold on to his unchanging hand, and I'm going to build my hopes on things eternal, and I'm going to hold to God's unchanging hand. Grab somebody by their hand and say, neighbor, endure the pain, endure the suffering, endure, because God is going to make it up to you, because I know what Romans 8 and 28 says, for those that love God, he's working it out for your good. It may not feel good, but it's working for my good. It may not look good, but I'm so glad that it's working for my good. The bad is working for my good. The hills are working for my good. The valleys are working for my good. The trouble is working for my good. Say yeah. Say yeah. So Jesus endured the cross. He endured the shame. But brothers and sisters, you've got to consider what Jesus went through. For the third verse says, for consider him that endured such a contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. In other words, Jesus not only endured the shame, he endured the cross, but he endured the contradiction of sinners, which means he endured the hostility, he endured the shame, he endured them laughing at him, he endured them talking about him, he endured them saying he's not the Son of God, he endured the shame, he endured the contradiction, the hostility, the suffering, the agony, the lies that they told on him, he endured that. Therefore, all that he endured, he became victorious over all that he endured, because the cross was not the end of the story. The cross was not the end of the story. But Jesus, I know it's not Easter, but can I tell you the story that Jesus went into a borrowed tomb, but on the third day he got up with all power in his hand. He became victorious over death, for he said, I got the keys to death, hell, and the grave, and all power is in my hand. Tell somebody, all power is in his hand. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Clap your hands and tell him, yeah. Say yeah. Jesus went through. And so, brothers and sisters, we have to endure and go through too. For 1 Peter 4:12 through 13 says, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials which come to try you, as if some strange thing has happened to you. But rejoice. Somebody shout rejoice. This is the reason why you can rejoice, in as much as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. It's not strange that you have to go through. It's not strange that you have to endure. It's not strange that you get sick. It's not strange that you have problems. It's not strange that you have fiery darts of the wicked come coming against you. But brothers and sisters, Peter says, rejoice, because now you are partakers of Christ's suffering, because Christ went through it. He's allowing me to go through it, but Jesus became victorious over it. And so I came to tell somebody, just like Jesus came victorious over it, you're going to be victorious. Tell somebody, neighbor, just like Jesus was victorious, I'm going to be victorious. I've got the victory. I've got the victory. Yes, I do. Yeah. Woo! Say yeah. Yeah. My God. But he says, rejoice. I know we're used to rejoicing after we come out of it. But now I'm talking to those that are the real saints. The real saints can rejoice while we're still going through it. We can rejoice while we're still going through it. It may not be going the way we want it to go, but when we come into the house of the Lord, we can still lift up our hands. We're going to still enter to his gates with thanksgiving, and enter his courts with praise. And we're going to be thankful, not that things are going the way I want them, but Lord, I thank you anyway. Lord, I'll praise you anyway. Lord, I'll give you glory anyway. Lord, I'll magnify you anyway. Is there anybody in this house? Can I preach this morning? Is there anybody in this house that can have a praise? I know things are not going the way you want them to go, but can you stop right here for about 30 seconds and give God a praise? Not that I'm out of it, but I'm praising God because after a while, I'm going to come through it. After a while, I'm going to come over it. After a while, say yeah. Oh Lord, oh Lord, and I'm closing with this, but as I was getting ready to finish this message, the Lord spoke to me out of his word and said, tell my people that they can't get distracted. Tell my people to stay focused because the blessing is around the corner. He told me to tell you Numbers 23:20. He says, behold, I have received commandment to bless, and he had blessed, and I cannot reverse it. Tell somebody, neighbor, God has already put it in motion, and it cannot be reversed. It's not going to be reversed. God has given us a commandment that he's getting ready to bless us, and it cannot be reversed. It cannot be turned back. It cannot go back. But if he said it, shall he not do it? If he spoke it, shall he not make it good? God has said it, and I'm standing on his word. I'm standing on his promises. I'm standing. Woo! Tell somebody it can't be reversed. Come on, tell somebody else it can't be reversed. Come on, get out your aisle, get out your seat and tell, find somebody and tell them it cannot be reversed. Get ready for an irreversible blessing. Get ready for the blessing that cannot be denied. Get right now. Oh, oh, oh. Get right now. I gotta leave it alone. But get right now. Oh, oh. Oh. It cannot be reversed. If God has put it out there, cannot be reversed. The devil's gonna make you think that God is not gonna do what he said. But he said, behold, I have received commandment to bless. In other words, I've received a commandment to bless you. And when I receive the commandment to bless you, no manager, no supervisor will be able to stop the blessings of God. They'll just give you favor. They don't even know why, but they don't understand that they've received a commandment to bless you. Everyone standing on your feet. Cannot be reversed. Can't be reversed. It's already in motion. And it cannot be reversed. This is the year of the crowning year of blessings. And we are getting ready for showers of blessings. As I told you last week, I'm not just saying it because, you know, it sounds good and I want to make you feel good. But I'm telling you what the Lord is saying to us. I'm telling you what the Lord is speaking to us. We've been praying and we've been fasting. We've been believing God. And God says, I've seen your tears. I've seen your tears. I've seen your tears. Sister Wilson, come here. The Lord just spoke to me and told me to tell you something. The Lord said he's getting ready to save your house. I'm not just... But somebody ought to give praise for her. Come on. Woo! It comes out of the Bashanda to Yoshata. If somebody needs your sons and daughters, say, come on and give God praise for her. God said when he will praise God for her, he'll begin to do it for you. Listen, when you've been praying, God hears you when you pray. Those things you've been praying for, God said, I heard you, I heard you, I hear you as you're praying, and your prayers have not gone unheard. But I'm going to do what I've already promised. Now, this is what I need you to do. This is what I need you to do. We're getting ready to get out of here, but this is what I need you to do. We're getting ready to give God some praise. I'm not talking about just a little, you know, thank you, Lord. Now, because if that's you, just, this is not for you. But this is for those that have a radical prayer request up before God. We're getting ready to give God some radical praise. I'm talking about, I don't want you, if you're embarrassed to do it, this is not for you. But for those that need God to do something, I'm going to count to three, and I want you to cry out, holler, scream, run, jump, whatever you got to do. But I'm going to give you about 30 to 40 seconds to do, Abba Shakanariyoshata, to get a praise out. One. This is not for embarrassed folk. If you're too embarrassed to do it, well, they going to look at me. They videotaping, and I don't want them to see me praising God. Two. Three. Come on and give him praise in here. God is working some stuff out in your praise. Woo! Woo! Go ahead and take a few more seconds and give him some praise in here. Somebody believe God in here. Get it in. This is your time. 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 You better get it in. We gotta move on. Woo! Woo! Oh, ba 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 da da ba sha. We gotta move on. But grab somebody by the hand. Grab somebody by the hand. Grab somebody by the hand. Grab them by both of the hands. Grab them by the hand. And I want you to look at them and say, neighbor, I don't know what you're going through right now. Tell them, I don't know how bad it is right now. But this praise is for you. I'm getting ready to give God praise, not for myself, but I'm getting ready to give God praise for you. Now come on and give God praise for your neighbor. Come on, come on, that God is gonna bring them through, that God's gonna bring them out. That God's going to deliver them. But the Lord is here right now. He come out of the basha, he come to the osha. Sister Bradley, this is when I just saw the Lord. Come, Sister Bradley, sister. Ooh, I just saw God doing this. This is what I just saw. Give me your hand. Give me your hand. I saw God pulling you out. I saw God pulling you out. I saw God pulling you out. I saw God. Oh, my, 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 my. Shut up, my, my. He come out of my home. Ho, ho. He come out of my shirt. Woo! That's what I saw God doing. Pulling you out. Grabbing your hand. And just pulling you out of it. Woo! All right. We got to move on. We got a long way to go. And I don't want to hold you too long today. The Lord said it's not going to end the way that you think it may end. But God said he's going to turn it around. That your tears have not been in vain. But God is getting ready to pull you through it. Now give him some glory and give him some praise. Hallelujah. Come on, everybody, give God a hand clap of praise in this house. Hallelujah. Lift your hands in the presence of the Lord. Father, we thank you today for your spirit. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you for touching and delivering and setting free. And we thank you for your word that you have settled in our hearts. We thank you for the word that you have settled in this house. That it cannot be reversed. And we pray, God, that we will stay focused on you. That we won't get distracted. We won't look to the right, to the left. But that we'll keep our eyes on Jesus. For you are the author and the finisher of our faith. And we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen. Give God praise in this house. Hallelujah. There may be someone who says, I don't know Jesus today. If that's you, say, I don't know Jesus. I want to know Jesus. If that's you, come to the altar now. We want to pray with you. Pray with you. Hallelujah. There may be someone who says, I want to be a member of Freedom Temple Church of God in Christ. If that's you, amen. God bless you today. God bless you today. God bless you today. Amen. God bless you today.